Good morning, sports fans. Welcome to the Cheap Seats on 96.3 FM, streaming live on the web at WLCNonline.com. Scott Kirby, Joe Ryan with you, Lloyd behind the camera, and Jim Ash, Loin, the producer.
Loin.
We are at the fairgrounds for the...
Jim's bringing me up. Can you hear me?
Check,
I
check.
I have the wrong one?
Yeah. We can hear you now.
You can hear you.
Yeah.
Is it bad? You know what? It's going to get worse because it's hot.
It is hot. My ears are sweating already.
I thought Loin would have put a tent up for us or something.
Well, Jim asked if we wanted up, but we had to go get it if we wanted it.
Boy, so, are you guys lazy.
Apparently, we didn't need it too bad. But we are at the fairgrounds by the, I guess you call this the pavilion. People call it the beer tent. It's not really a tent, but...
Beer barn.
Chili cook-off today. Smelling real good.
Yeah,
isn't it?
There's some stuff that smells good.
We got some slobbers a-flying because it's hard to talk when you smell that stuff.
I went over and visited a little bit, and they all think they're going to get first place. I know that. There's some confidence in there.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
There's some championship chili in there.
Good deal. Looks like there's several competitors. Looks like they're just getting started. The guy behind us, he's browning his hamburger or sausage, whatever it is right now. So,
and that smells good.
It's probably not going to be done by the time our show's
there's
over.
All kinds of different little techniques and mixtures and ingredients that these guys all throw in to give theirs their certain spice or flavor, if you will.
Yeah.
Good. We need to hang around for it.
Yeah, they are setting up the stage for the big show tonight. Dustin Lynch and Brushville opening up for them. And don't forget to join Big Daddy Jim and Jeff Number 2 and Lisa the Fix 96 Prize Girl tonight live in the Merchants Building from 6 to 8 for the Classic Rock Experience Show. And when you bring four or more non-perishable food items for the Lincoln County or Lincoln Logan Food Pantry, you'll receive a great prize.
A great one,
not just a good one. A great one.
Great one.
Joe, we got a bag of
I'll hold this up here
kettle,
a little bit so they can
kettle
see
corn
it
here.
Yes, now I'm probably not going to say this very well, but a gentleman I bumped into on the way over here told me he's from Mickey Triple D's Sweet and Sassy Kettle Corn. Mickey and Gary Emus, he told me they're from the Bolingbrook area. They're here at the fair.
Bolingbrook, Chicago.
Yep, up Chicago way. They have some Blackhawk shirts on, but he said he's a Cardinal baseball fan, which made me like him.
Well, that's how's that possible?
He said he grew up in St. Louis before they moved up there.
We'll let him slide.
What he's wanting to bring to our attention, though, is he's got what's going on at the fair this week, today, rest of the week. Patriot Kettle Corn. It's blue raspberry, cinnamon, and regular kettle corn all mixed up in this bag. And this bag is $10, and immediately $3 of it is donated to the Gary Sensing Wounded Warrior Fund.
Gary Sinise.
Oh, yeah, my God. Say it. Yeah, I was going to say. I can't read that. Look at it.
Gary Sheen. You don't know Gary Sinise?
I can't read that. Yes, I do, but I was trying
Lieutenant
to read
Lieutenant Dan? You don't know Lieutenant Dan?
I was going to say, I can't read this. The Wounded Warrior Fund. I'm glad I could entertain you, Chuckles.
Oh, boy. I need to go back to Florida.
So stop by and support. You know, they're giving $3. Going to go out there and help some of our veterans with Agent Orange and other things that are going on. And they have a phone here if you'd be interested, 815-999-2695, to get a hold of them. That's all I have. Yeah, just that written on there. So stop out. I'm sure some of these guys in here are going to be wanting to get at it. So that's all I have on that.
Well, Gary,
what's his name?
Gary Singing will be very happy.
That's funny.
Yeah, but Gary Sinise, very involved.
Sinise.
You know, his role in Forrest Gump, he was injured in a war, and he's very active and involved in Wounded Warriors. And so, you know, a lot of people overlook that. You know, these soldiers come home, and they're missing arms and legs, and people just kind of forget about them. Well, they got to live the rest of their life, and they need this, and, you know, there's a lot of rehabilitation, a lot of therapy, and, you know, so that's a great program. And you don't hear a lot of that. You know, there's so many charities and people raising money for things, and sometimes this gets overlooked. So that's a great thing.
He told me immediately, he said, if you stand around and watch them immediately, when you pay the $10, they put $7 in the register, and they take $3 out to put in this fund. So
that's great. And, you know, not only patriotic, you could also pass this on for Christmas. I mean,
Christmas,
Lincoln Railer popcorn. Maybe we could sell that in a concession stand.
That's
and
a good idea.
You know, help him out a little bit. So
help him raise
we'll
some
see
money for it.
Yeah. What else? We got the 1975 football team here.
They're legendary. The 1975
9
football team. Got beat in the playoffs.
Like 9-8 or 8-7, yeah, like a
we're
point.
We're going to talk about that. That's why I won't talk about it. But
we won't.
Yes. A phenomenal run, being undefeated. And it's their 40-year class reunion. They were out here last night, I guess, kind of celebrating. I'm going to let those guys explain some of what's going on today, but they're having a picture taken, another team picture taken today later on at the high school. Sam Knox, I guess, kind of organized that a little bit. I know Sam Bedonia will be in here later this week or later today, and they're going to do something out at the Knights of Columbus Hall or something. But some interesting characters from this 75 team going to be over here. I think Steve Sauer knows a few of them. Steve, were you around then? You were around in 1975, Steve?
Yeah. Well, Joe, this time of year, I said it last year, it's like Christmas. Football's right around the corner. High school football starts up Monday. All the NFL training camps are fired up. College football's fired up. They'll be starting here in
a week. It's the best time of the year.
It's the best time of the year. And
better in October.
Well,
because it's hot.
And
yes.
It's kind of, to be honest with you, it's kind of snuck up on me because this year the Cubs are actually in a playoff hunt. Usually this time of year it's full-blown football. But it's kind of exciting this year when the Cubbies are doing so well. And you don't have to focus on football so early. Now there's still a lot of baseball left. Maybe in 2 or 3 weeks I'll be in full football mode. But right now, it's baseball.
We've had that conversation before. I'm done talking about baseball. Baseball season's over with.
Well, I'm not done talking about baseball right now.
Oh, okay.
Cubs are a game and a half over the San Francisco Giants for that second wild card.
How many games over 500 are they, which I thought was surprising?
11 or –
Yes, 10 or 11 games.
11 or 12 now.
That's surprising for right now.
Don't even look at me, Lloyd.
Is Joe Madden the difference?
I don't know. You know, they say a coach, he might be a 4 or 5-game difference from last year. Well, it's more than that. But I think it's just the young talent.
If they win the World Series, he might run for president, Republican
He'll
Party.
Win.
Jump in.
He'll
Give
win.
Him another one.
Yeah. But when I was gone – in Florida, the Phillies beat up on my Cubbies, and Lloyd just gives me that look.
Oh,
I
yeah.
Lloyd
loves the Phillies.
Yeah, he does. But speaking of football, Lincoln Youth Football, they started their practice last week. They're having a ribeye sandwich fundraiser today at IGA from 10 to 2. I think the sandwiches are $4. So get on out there, and you know everybody's had an IGA
anything,
ribeye sandwich
matter,
or
yeah.
pork chop, and they're
delicious.
Just, they're phenomenal. So get on out there,
and hats off again to the IGA for giving back to the community again. They always do. And youth football ready to go. And I do want to throw this out there for if, in case you've been under a rock. Football does start Monday, 7 a.m., and these are mandatory practices that you have to be at to get your 12 practices in so you can start the season and be able to start the first game. So there's
right.
no more laying around.
And
you got to get out there Monday morning.
Yeah, and that's the same thing with youth football, too. You have to have so many practices before you can play a game. And their games are starting here in a couple weeks, so I don't think it's too late to sign up. If you want to sign up, get a hold of Steve Ferris or get out to Growl. I think they might still have some sign-up forms. But yeah, Joe, it's here. It's amongst us. Football.
Amongst us.
It is here.
Fantasy football will be around the corner.
Football.
We'll have that going on.
Have we talked any more about doing it on a 96.3 WLCN fantasy football?
Probably not.
Oh, I'm in charge and I was gone.
Yeah.
Well, we need to. So let's start planning on that. We need to set a date. Huh? 2 weeks in Joe's pool.
That's we're gonna draft in the pool.
Jim said. Jim just made that decision.
There we go.
Fantasy football draft in
that
the
is
pool.
A,
we don't have to be in the pool, do we?
That is a managerial decision.
The big cheese said at Joe's.
There you go.
So
that could
better,
work.
You better let Michelle know that 2 weeks. there might
a
be
draft
a
draft in the pool.
There might be a back. Your backyard might be full of stupid, drunk fantasy
pet
football
tricks.
People. Next Saturday, we'll be downtown Emden at the Stag Grand Bar and Family Friendly Grill for the annual ALS walk run. Something else going on that day, Joe, out at the KC's. They're putting on a I don't know if you talked about it the past couple weeks. Mm-hmm. They're putting on a wiffle ball tournament.
Oh, yes, we did mention it.
You know, so you just go out there. I think the sign-ups start at 10 o'clock. It's for the same deal, ALS, I do believe, and that ought to be pretty fun. You ever participate?
I haven't played out there, and I wasn't. I think they had it one or two times before, but I never went. But it's they're playing on that parking lot, right?
I would assume. I don't know where else they would play.
It's it seems. Yeah, I don't know. You're not going to die for any balls, are you?
You're not going to slide into.
We're not going to run any bases.
You know.
Yeah, I'm old. We don't need to do that.
Okay.
You well, checking that?
Yeah. John Andrews is putting it all together, Junior. He contacted me. So if you have any questions, I think they have a website up or you can go on. It's we have a link on our cheap seats that you can go to and find out all the information. Not sure off the top of my head how much it is to get in. I'm wanting to say $30 a team. I could be wrong. But, yeah, it's for a great cause.
We mentioned it last week. We had the info on it, but I don't see it right now.
Yeah, I mean, you could actually probably do both. Go to Emden. Do the run, walk thing.
Wear yourself down and go play some wiffle ball.
And go out, and there will be some refreshments available there at the KC's, and play some wiffle ball and raise money for a good cause.
I think it's a good idea.
Yeah. What time we got here? Right in front of me. Wow. Was any closer, it would have bit me.
That's
9:15.
Right.
Take a commercial break. We'll get these guys on. They probably eat up the rest of the show.
Yeah, stay tuned. We're going to put some players on for the 1975 football team.
Like
we're just going to let them babble, tell stories.
I mean, we got
I think
in
they're
there.
All ready to
Two,
go.
Three, four, about eight or nine people in there maybe. So that's almost a full team.
That's a full team. Let's bring them out. We're going to have them demonstrate some form tackling,
team. There's
some blocking.
There's 11 people on a...
Yeah, I thought you meant baseball. We could start a baseball team with those nine.
Well, we still have to be one short.
Well, 9, 10, 11.
Eight. Oh, we're playing?
Yeah.
They want us to play.
I'm sure they do.
All right. Well, hey, let's take a break. We'll be back after these messages.
You guys had to listen to this whole sweet back
here. Ready, Steve? Andy?
Yeah. This show's rocking.
Mick? Okay. All right, fellas.
Like a hardware.
All right.
He opened up his own and then franchised it.
Yeah.
He's got 396.
Welcome back to the Cheap Seats on 96.3 FM. Streaming online at WLCNonline.com. And we are at the Logan County Fairgrounds. And today we have the 1975 Lincoln Railsplitter Football Team with us. Good morning, fellas.
Good morning.
Hey. All chipper. And we got the coach with us this morning.
One of the coaches.
Well, the coach today, because you're the only coach. Well, Joe probably coached back then, didn't he?
Yeah,
was he coaching with you?
No.
I wasn't even born yet.
Well, he's been coaching Railsplitter football for how many years?
I wasn't born yet when he started in
1975.
Hey, Coach Larry Shoup with us. Coach, how you doing?
Doing fine.
And let's go back in time. When did you start Lincoln High School?
I came here in 1970.
1970. And you started coach football first year there?
Yes.
And let's just jump to 1975. You were coaching what?
Coach the receivers and defensive backs.
Under head coach?
Gene McDonald. One of the great ones.
Yep, right. Who recently passed away. Well, how long has it been? A couple years? A
couple of years, I think.
Coach Mack was a good dude.
Oh, yes.
I sent Andy a text, see if he wanted to come out. I haven't heard from him, but thought he might come out and say hey. Coach, let's talk about this 75 season, because that's why you're here for this 40-year reunion. They're legends. The only undefeated team in Lincoln High School football history, I believe.
Well, we had one loss.
Well, conference, undefeated conference.
Regular season.
In the
regular
real Big 12.
Schedule, yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about when did you know that team was going to be good? Did you know it the year before?
Yeah, we knew we were going to be pretty good. We didn't know how good.
And then in the season, in the very beginning, didn't we have some trauma there in the beginning with our quarterback?
Yeah, if I remember right, the first game was always the Friday after Labor Day, and Labor Day morning we're practicing and working on goal line offense and trying to score from like the 3-yard line, 2-yard line, and it was the last live really contact, and I can't remember what happened. We ran some type of play, and Greg Prisk, our quarterback, went down in a heap with a broken shoulder.
Ooh. Now, was he a junior or senior?
He was a senior.
He was a senior that year? And so then did it scare you about the season or not?
Yeah, we thought, what are we going to do now? But fortunately, we had two other quarterbacks that stepped in and did a great job all year.
Let's talk about them. Who were they?
Doug Reifsteck and Jeff McClard was a junior. Jeff's Doug was a senior.
Yep. Jeff's here today.
Jeff's here. Look at that. We knew that. We're going to bring him on up in here and talk. And Doug Reifsteck, no.
He's not here. He's not here.
Doug said he was taking his parents to breakfast this morning somewhere. Oh, he'd already made that commitment before he knew this. So
he's a good boy then.
Mm-hmm.
So you had to jump on Jeff's back, and he carried you a little bit or not?
No,
hey, grab that mic. Come on.
That wasn't the case. No, Doug and I split time. And, he was a senior. I was a junior. And I think by the end of the year, Doug was he played in the playoff game, I think. But, we made do. Luckily, we had a huge line. We had great running backs. And so we could give the ball, and just pounded the ball most of the time.
Huge line and great running backs. Yeah. Yeah, I saw those two just pump out a little
right
bit. You knew
right
that.
They're standing right here.
Oh, I know. Yeah, I think Zeke's got a small T-shirt on. That thing. Yeah. So what position were you playing before you?
I probably would have been in the back, defensive back somewhere.
Yeah.
So then all of a sudden, wow, before you even get started, you got to jump into that quarterback role.
Yeah, I was thinking I'd probably played 3 or 4 games as a quarterback my freshman year, and then I got hurt after 3 games my sophomore year. So I'd probably played quarterback 7 games by the time I was thrown into this. So it was interesting.
So a little nervous.
A lot nervous. Yeah.
And now we got another quarterback stepped
here's
up.
There's the quarterback.
Yeah, coming in late. Bring it on.
Just talking about you.
We talked him up. There he is.
Step on in. They've been talking about you.
I'll bet.
Take that mic. You're all stars today. We're all stars.
Great.
Okay, so you're not really the starting quarterback, right? And then we get an injured quarterback, and all of a sudden you're thrown in that role. Correct?
Yeah, I thought I had a play sealed up at the defensive safety, which means I got to hit people instead of getting hit. That didn't work out so well.
And are you a week out from your first game? Or is it?
No, it's right before our first game.
Right before.
So it's the last practice before your first game, and now you're thrown in that role. You probably haven't been.
And my fullback's the one that took him out. So.
Where's the kid?
He just got in the way.
Now, see, that's something I haven't been told.
Lateral damage.
Was it cheap?
No.
Oh, okay.
I looked up and there he was.
Zeke didn't have any cheap hits.
He tried to take him head on.
Zeke was a brute force. Okay, so you can't get so tell us a little bit. So you're ready to go or not? Nervous or
right
go?
Now?
No, then. Did you go? You nervous now?
Yeah, then.
This is live everywhere. They can see you everywhere.
I was third string, I think. Yeah. I was thinking I'm going to be on the bench again. I played behind Greg Priss since I was in fifth grade. So
he's an athlete.
Yeah, he was. Well, I think the newspaper guy called him Apollo.
Yeah, Apollo.
Was that Dick Houston?
Yep. Called him Apollo. So, and I had to play behind Greg all the time. So I thought, well, I'm going to finally get out from underneath his umbrella, and I'll be able to go play, somewhere on defense. And that just didn't turn out to be the case. But, I did have one good thing. I had about, 5 guys regular, but 6 or 7 guys that got up in front of me. So I didn't have too much to worry about.
You had a hell of a line.
Yeah.
And that's where we're going next. So you couldn't have done it without these other guys.
Heck no, I'd go back there and pitch a tent and have fun, throw the ball to whoever happened to be open.
Well, let's talk to some of those animals that were up front. And go ahead and tell them who you are. Oh. So all our viewers out there.
Tom Schoenauer. Myself, Gus.
Yeah, what lineman we have sitting up here?
Kevin Thompson.
I'm Kevin Thompson. I played left guard.
Who else was on the line?
Well, it was Hazley, Ott, and Spanton.
Well, we're the only trench diggers that are here today, though.
Yeah.
Hazley, Ott, and Spanton. Where's Spanton at? He's a no-show?
He's a no-show.
He's retired.
Well, we know he doesn't do anything. How come he can't be here? And I know he can watch someday. Spanton, you heard
that. One of the things that in Coach Shoup, I can testify to this, is that back in the day, you're talking the mid-70s in small communities like that, the size that we had was, I don't think we've seen it since then, really.
No, probably not.
We had Dave Clem was 6'2", 280. Yeah, Dan Ott, may he rest in peace, was 6'3", 275. Of course, I was the Adonis at 190. No, I was at 6'3". I won't say my weight. But we had a lot of big guys. Zeke, 2 1/4, 5'10". Gus, running back. To have a major college running back size like that, you just don't see it in around.
Let me say one thing. Actually, we had an extra lineman. Because the year before, Zeke had been, I think, an all-conference guard. Mm-hmm. And we moved him to fullback.
Right.
So when we ran off tackle, you got an extra lineman. And leading the play or around the end. I know there were defensive backs cringing when Gus got around the end and all there's one little defensive back there.
Weighing a buck 50.
And we always told the running backs, stay on your shoulder, never dip, because the defensive back's got to come through the blocker to get to you. And they didn't want to come through Zeke.
Yeah, we're going to talk to Zeke here in a little bit. So the line was that was the key, huh? Guys anchored the line.
Denny's not here, but Denny Derrickson is one of the greatest offensive line coaches I've ever been around. And I've been around football for years. So.
Well, I told Tommy this yesterday, whenever it was I talked to you, that I went to a coaching clinic in Quincy in April, and Denny Derrickson was there, and he spoke. He's now back coaching. Recently lost his wife, and he started coaching again and up north. And he gave a presentation on the double dive, and it was phenomenal. And he would throw film up and then just turn around and go, no, that's not right. He went the wrong way. I don't know why he put this clip on there. He went the wrong way on that, and then he'd show a different one. He was phenomenal. So I took a picture and threw it out on Facebook, but I don't know if anybody saw it.
And I think that was one of the keys, too, of that 75 season. We did have a really good coaching staff with Larry and Denny and stuff like that. When you would go in on a Monday and get one of Denny Derrickson's scouting reports, it was amazing. He gave you so much detail. You know, Vince Arnold's their middle linebacker for Urbana. He's got a bad left knee. Take it out, you know, type of thing. Which we did successfully.
No, we never did that kind of thing.
I don't think Vince is listening. He's from Urbana, so we're safe. But no, he was really good at just.
Always had a great speech before the game. I mean, it was something you really waited for. I mean, it really fired you up for the linemen.
Just want to run through the wall.
Yeah, you started about half hour away from
right
there.
Go right through that wall.
No, and that was the thing, too, with it. I talked to Joe, was that. We as a group were together all 4 years. We played a lot of us did,
and we played the youth ball too.
We played the youth football, and but we never had a defeat. We always had a winning season. We never had a losing season in the 4 years that we were there.
So you kind of knew it was gonna go this way, but
I think Coach Shoup said it right. We knew we were gonna have a good team. Mm-hmm. We just didn't know how good. And There were some teams in the conference at the time that, you know, weren't too tough, but there were some great teams in the conference. Champaign Central was good. We were neck and neck with them. Danville
and Springfield.
Springfield and stuff. So,
did you run out of a tight end formation or no?
Yeah, we
ran.
Back Kuznick was
football. Where's different back then?
Kuznick and Clem both. Skinny Clem.
Yeah, Dave was here last night.
Dave said he wasn't going to come to this. He was going to let some of you superstars talk. That's what he told me. Some of the glory guys, that's what he told me.
And to our all-stater here. Gus.
Well, I was going to say, let's move to the backfield then. We talked about that line. Let's go to the backfield. You guys have these two studs back here, right?
Oh, yeah.
Throw them a mic. Let them get on there and talk. Mm-hmm. Tell all fans who you are.
Hello.
Well,
I played fullback. My name is Zeke. Played fullback. And anything else you want to know?
Linebacker.
I played linebacker on defense.
Well, we're going to go to defense, but we're just babbling about this offense. So you got were you the main man blocking?
I was the main blocking back mostly, and I really liked it on sweeps.
We did let you touch the ball.
He gained a lot of yards, and we get to smash some people. Gotcha. That was the best part.
And Mr. Biskin just gave me some info here. Zerkhammer rushed for 570 yards and averaged 5 yards a carry. That's pretty good.
Wow, really?
Yeah. Which means they probably must have been scared of Gus.
I got the ball like if we get real close. If we get 1 yard away, I always got the ball there. I scored a lot of touchdowns, though.
Who had more touchdowns, you or Gus?
I don't know.
Oh, Gus did.
Yeah, probably Gus.
Well, I'll tell you what, one of you was helping the other one, so I'll let these guys decide. Who was making the other one a better runner? Were they scared of Gus, so Zeke got some yards, you know what I mean?
But now you got to remember, Zeke played guard the year before, so we weren't quite sure what was going on.
I could not run very
but
many.
By mid-season, he started adjusting in as a running back, so we started giving him the ball.
North and
the
south.
Tackles. Yeah. Straight ahead.
That's all you.
Zeke, pass that over to Gus. Let's talk to Mark Gazowskis. Rushed for 1,292 yards and averaged 8 yards a carry.
Dang.
Wow, that's pretty good.
Thank you.
You send something to Zeke for Christmas every year or not?
Yeah, I bought him a car.
I still have that car.
It's called a Hot Wheel.
That's right. 1,292, were you playing both ways?
Yes, played linebacker too.
Yeah, so you didn't get a break.
No.
Well, mine too, that, you know, you got to credit your line with that, and I guess Zeke's getting a few blocks. And
right. Had a great line. Double ways. Yeah.
If you guys
had a fantastic line, Zeke, in front of me, it, you know, we just gelled so well that there was no stopping us, really.
What's your favorite?
Second count.
Yeah, terrific.
What was your favorite play, Gus? What did you want him to call so you get the
just
ball?
Just as long as the ball came to me.
Give me the
that
ball.
That was my
play.
Favorite.
Coach, what was the bread and butter play over there if you needed those 4 yards?
I'm just sitting here thinking when you just ask him that, does he remember what the plays were called?
Wow. What formation
either,
did you run?
Is either I plus pro. Or minus 32?
Hi.
Out of the eye, yes. Tight end and a triple either a slot on one side or a flank or a pro set with a flanker and a split end. Yep. That's about it.
So they didn't run a jet sweep back then.
No,
no jet sweeps yet. Thank goodness.
Bubble we used to screen. Run our silly sweep. We called it. I remember
silly
that.
Sweep. Yeah. Well, who were the wide receivers then?
Dave.
Well, we'll ask him a few questions over here.
I'm trying to think who was
Dave. You can fill in better than that.
Dave,
a couple of Daves.
Tell them who you are, Dave. What number were you?
Number 80.
Number 80.
Always split out there as a decoy. Watch him back, watch him run. Run down the field and maybe be down running as like Stan Hawkins or Gus is walking into the end zone shaking their hands. I'd be one of the first ones on the scene to go, touchdown.
Hey, nice job.
Yeah,
get
nice
your picture
job.
In the paper on
yeah,
that.
Yeah. Did they allow special teams like that.
Could we get the ball out to you?
Yeah, well, we had to, every once in a while, we had to throw a quick hitch out there to keep them honest. We throw every once in a while, but didn't have to when you're averaging, you know, those kinds of runs when you got Gus running, you know, 7-8 yards a carry and Zeke running 5. And we had another guy out there by the name of Stan
I'll
Hawkins.
Say Stan Hawkins in here.
Yeah, he was really fast. And he averaged over, I think, 8 yards a carry.
Yeah, 8 yards a carry also. So
oh, yeah.
we were a running football team.
So, and those stats, by the way, were supplied by Dick Houston.
Dick Houston got
Lincoln
these out.
Courier. Back
hey,
in the day.
Dick Houston's still out there.
So that's what I heard. He's in Springfield. That's
yeah.
what I heard.
They said, saw him dancing somewhere the other day. That's what a guy told me. He was out dancing.
You're,
yeah.
All right, but so, no, we had a – first of all, I just want to say all these guys, we've always stayed close. It was a great, great group. We had a 20-year reunion, and a whole bunch of guys came back. But when we said we're putting this together, there's guys coming from all across the country. I live out in Cincinnati. There's guys from Kansas, all Chicago, a bunch of guys from Chicago. Coach Shoup lives out in Kentucky. So when we started putting this together, it was kind of a last-minute thing, like 2 months in the works. It was hard trying to find, track everybody down. But we have a lot of guys that wanted to be here. And hopefully in 10 more years, we're going to really put it out. We're going to have the 50th.
50, yeah, that's going to be a big deal.
And we also want to say there's four of us that couldn't make it back. Coach Mack, Dan Ott, Steve Pluth, and Frank Rodriguez. So we feel very fortunate that we're all still probably. There's 37 of us, you know, on the team. And so we only lost three of the teammates, but.
That's pretty good for the,
yeah, it is.
The 40 years.
Yep.
That's
yep.
pretty good.
Hey, Joe, well, let's take a quick break. We'll regroup and get some of these guys in the back up here. And,
oh, yeah.
Oh, we're gonna,
yeah.
Hey, you're all going to talk.
Yeah,
we'll finish this show out with the 1975 football team. So don't go anywhere. We'll be back after these messages.
Well, this is your intro, Bobby.
Yeah. You can't hear it. You got to give
it
a
rocking it.
No, you bring it.
Welcome back to the Cheap Seats on 96.3 FM on the web at WLCNonline.com. And we are back at the fairgrounds, and we're going to continue this segment with the 1975 Lincoln Railer football team. And who do we have with the mic here? He's going to talk to defense.
Bob Cody.
And are you the defensive specialist?
Well,
because they said defense, and they gave you the mic.
We had a defense that was second to none.
Pull it up there.
And
there you go. Like a rock.
Yeah, I was just one of the guys.
Well, we want to hear about his defense. What was it? What were you playing?
I played inside linebacker.
What was it? What was our scheme, though? 4-3?
4-4.
Yeah.
R5.
I was the nose guard a lot of times.
All right.
We switched to 5-3 back to 4-4.
It was most of our teams in the Big 12 running the ball then back then, right?
Yeah.
Option anywhere?
That was our bread and butter play. We were talking off when we were offline.
We ran a lot of options.
A lot of option. Is your so let's hear about that defense. You were at the nose.
I was at the nose. Zeke.
They always tell me you're a bad dude. I'm telling you, Dave Schoenauer told me you're a bad dude. That's what they told me.
Well, let me tell you, you know what kind of size was on this team. I was probably the smallest guy on the team.
And, but the scrappiest.
To go in there and play with these guys was, 40 years later, we're back. I live in Florida. And I cherish coming back and being with these guys.
Flying in to see these guys.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about that, the defense. So we had, who's on defensive line? Jump in, Tommy. Tell them.
There's myself on one side and Dan out on the other, and because you had the two down linemen for the 4-4. The defensive ends were Dave Klim and Greg Cox, right?
Oh, I forgot about Greg Cox.
And
yeah.
Greg's out in Nevada, been out there for a long time.
You talk about the size of these guys. You know, I was 5'7", 165 pounds, and played inside. And it was like
Zeke and Bobby were the two insides on the defense, and then Gus would play outside. Mike and what was it? Willie was the other outside linebacker. I'm trying to remember who was that. Randy Feast.
Yeah. Randy Feast.
Yeah.
Hey guys, we got a tweet from a listener, Justin All. He's wanting to know if Doug is buying lunch at Culver's afterwards.
Sure he is.
I think so, right?
So Justin, I didn't get an answer, so probably not.
Just charge at the window, right?
You're on your own.
Charge at the drive up. Is anybody want to talk about defense anymore?
We just had a great defense. I mean, I think that we had a great offense, but
we allowed 8 points a game.
I mean, when you look at the guys that were
on the very bottom,
you know, the offense that we had, our defense was probably better than our offense.
Offense averaged 25 points a game, and the defense allowed 9.
There you go.
You're going to win most of your games if you score more than they do.
The last game, we were ahead like 48 to
nothing. Pop in there.
Against Decatur, we were like ahead 48-7 or something.
Yeah.
And we all went out of the game, and they scored like 2 touchdowns. So
remembering
they screwed
that.
Up our average.
Do we want to call some of those guys out that were out there then?
In that game also, if you recall, Zeke, to the best of my knowledge, kicked the only field goal up to that point.
That was extra point,
I'm saying, in Lincoln High School history. They always used to run. We never had kickers.
We never tried.
So they always run the 2-point conversion.
I don't know exactly why we tried it. We did.
We did. But you actually killed it. You kicked a field goal during the season, didn't you?
Now, I wish I would have kicked one the last game.
Was it soccer style or head on?
Yeah.
I'm going to guess head on.
Head on. Like that one guy, you pound him the head.
Looked like Tom Dempsey with 2 feet instead of 1.5.
He's passing the mic now. 9-0 in the regular season, Big 12 champs. And let's talk about the season. And throw that mic around and tell them who you are so I know who you are when you take it.
My favorite thing of the season.
Yeah, give us a big moment.
Was our 7th game. We were playing Champaign Central. And my brother went to all the games, and he listened to the radio. And us and Danville were tied with no losses. And we were playing Champaign, and Danville was playing Springfield. So my brother yells at me, and he goes, "Springfield just beat Danville. Springfield just beat Danville." And I go, "Oh, wow." So I told everybody. And we were winning 12-10. They lined up to kick field goal that would have beat us. And this big guy came in and blocked it.
No, it wasn't me.
Don't tell him. He's giving you some kudos.
He got some kudos.
It was him. If I remember, you didn't finish the game.
I got kicked out of the game.
Might be another story.
Who was it? Skinny Clem?
It was Dave Clem. And I've told the story several times over the years.
And you told everybody you blocked it.
No, I didn't. But the funny part about that was is Dave knew the importance of blocking that kick, so he didn't block it. He jumped on the ball, and the kicker followed through and kicked him right in the head.
But he
held on to the ball, and he knew the kicker knew. Hey, no field goal now. So he's eyeballing his head. He's gonna try to decapitate him. But Dave held on to the ball, and that was the game.
So that kept the perfect season and won the Big 12.
And it poured down rain.
The very end of the game.
Right after the game, we ran out on the field.
It was just pouring.
We knew at that point
we went in the locker room, and it was raining so hard, and all of us just, we knew we were leading the Big 12. We all came back out on the field, and we're doing body slides and stuff. My aunt used to tape the games, and he just starts screaming, "Oh, my God, here they come!" And he's just doing play-by-play, everybody diving in the mud.
So tell the fans who you are. Tell us a story. We're going around now. You got her, Gus. Tell them.
I just told a story.
That's yours? You're done? That's your favorite moment?
No.
Slide, slip and slide?
I can't tell a lot of them.
Okay, I'm about to go.
No, you're staying. You got another story you want to throw out, Gus? We'll come back to you. Somebody take that mic and tell us a story. Tell us who you are. Tell us a story. Here you go.
My favorite play.
You got to tell them who you are. They can't see.
I'm Kevin Thompson. I played left guard, gotcha. Outside linebacker. Best thing was our senior year or junior year, we got beat by Bloomington.
Oh, yeah.
Pretty bad.
Junior year, 37.
So Bloomington came up our senior year, and we're all just out for blood. And first play, we call a sweep, and it was the sweetest sight I ever saw because I round the corner, and there's Gus just running down the sideline. First play of the game, touchdown. I think we beat him, 33 to something.
We
blew him out. We blew him totally out. Yeah. And that was a sweet revenge for us.
We were
next year, I heard they came back and kicked the snot out of the thing, but I didn't give a damn about that.
Where's that bleep button at?
I'll kick it to yours.
Okay, well, I did my story.
Somebody jump and grab it.
My name's Dave Bush. I played wide receiver. I was relating this story earlier to Mark. I remember after our freshman year, we had this ton of people out. The season was over, and Coach Mack came in and made a speech, and he said, "We're going to be something great." He said he encouraged everybody to come back out and keep it, hanging it out for the next 3 years, and he was right. One of the unique things I think about our team is that we really didn't have a weak spot. You know, you can look at the stats between Mark and Zeke, but they complemented each other perfectly. And so the other team couldn't say, okay, we'll dial in on Kazauskas. If we stop him, we got it made, because Zurkhammer come in and fill the shoes, and they complemented each other perfectly. And when you throw in the beefcakes that we had up in the front line, it was a no-brainer. So.
And did you only have like the one major injury for the entire season?
Yeah.
Really, everybody else stayed healthy.
As far as I remember.
Well, Gus got injured. Steve Decatur game.
Right, the last game, and yeah. I always felt bad for Greg getting hurt in practice and stuff, but he's taking stride. So,
not to interrupt you, but what you said about Greg, that I think that's one of the, when you talk about stories of that team, you started off with the right guy, with Doug Reifstek.
Because
Doug found himself thrown into, he had some talent around him and stuff like that, but just thrown into a situation that a lot of people wouldn't have stepped up, and hit that, stride. And he did. Doug stepped up. That, to me, that was the hero of that team.
Players make plays.
They wrote really us off did. When Chris went down.
Yeah.
They said,
yeah.
Lincoln, they lost their chance of doing anything this year.
Yeah.
The star quarterback, Apollo, he won't be playing. So we have these two backup quarterbacks.
These two backup,
and
yeah.
They did great. Yeah. I mean, every other game they switched off and on. And we complimented each other pretty well.
I don't think there could have been a better stand-in than Doug. Yeah. Here he is.
And here he is. I don't have your stats, do I?
Hey, and
you don't want to see him.
He's old. He's old. Well, and Jeff McClard gets a lot of that credit, too, because, you're only as good as your competition most of the time. And Jeff pushed each other back and forth all season long to compete, so you couldn't rest on your laurels. You couldn't kind of slack off and, I'll give it to the line or the running backs to deal with it. We had to step up, and both of us, I think, did a pretty fair job of that. But I'll tell you that, I had a lot of favorite plays, and Kevin stole my thunder on Bloomington because that was so sweet when we beat their butts.
Beep.
That after that game, that was my favorite game. But the secret to most of this team was we all kind of ran in different cliques and different groups, but when we were in the football season, we all ran together, and we did things that the police didn't want to hear about, or some of our parents didn't want to, but our coaches.
Coach Shoup doesn't want to hear about it.
But no, they heard about him.
But I'll tell you what, when we were doing something, we were all doing it together, and we were having a lot of fun doing it. And it was, that's probably the secret to this team, is there wasn't any, I don't think there was any jealousy for the most part. Guys all, understood their role, whether it was playing on the field or being a backup and being ready to go. And that's really kind of the secret of this team was. And like they said, the coaching staff got us all prepared for games. So I'll tell you, those are great memories.
Right? I would be interested to ask Coach Shoup is how we were as a team, yeah, as far as coaching goes. You've coached, all your life. What was the 75 team? Were we coachable or
incorrigible? Very coachable. Back then, we just shot you if you didn't work. No, very good. You told you something. to do and did it and busted your rear to get it done. And I've coached recently here, and it's a little different these days, I think. But you guys were great, worked hard, and maybe didn't like it all the time. But yeah. I know all you guys, especially the linemen, love Coach Derrick's. But I think 40 years ago, you weren't sure you did that while practice was going on. But no, you were great. Great memories of some of the practices and the games especially. I think my favorite game was probably the Springfield game. Because after Danville, Springfield beat Danville, then they were up for us, and it was because we didn't play Danville that year.
Right.
So it was between us and Springfield, and we struggled the first half and then came out in the second half and just ran the ball down their throat, said, here it is, stop us, and they couldn't.
And we played it. That game was at home, wasn't it?
Yes, it was a home game, yeah. Huge crowd. It just kind of electric that night. So.
Now, did you guys play any other sports or just strictly football? Did you play them all?
I was wrestling in the track.
Wrestling, track,
basketball.
Shot put thrower, discus, or oh, I was 4x100.
No.
anybody else?
Basketball, I mean, and baseball.
Basketball, baseball.
Zeke, yeah. Zeke baseball, same. Baseball, basketball, my wrestling, sophomore year.
A lot of us wrestled till we got to be heavyweights, and we couldn't beat Clem.
Yeah, we couldn't.
He just best to get out.
But a lot of us from the football team that knew him, that after football season was over, we didn't necessarily get on the wrestling team, but we went to practice. And there was Zeke and I and Dan Ott and Bucky Washam. And it was just so Dave Clem could get a workout, and it was to his advantage because he, you know, most heavyweights, there's nobody to wrestle with for competition during the week. So
I just watched that show last night on the Munich Olympics that he would have had a chance to have been in, except for we boycotted him.
Yeah.
Wow.
Could have had a good chance.
The Jeff, you want to throw something out there?
Probably the one play I remember most was not my brightest moment. I think it was the first game. Did we play Lampier?
Yeah.
So it was a quarterback read option play, and I took it away from Zeke and was going to pitch it to Mark, and I pitched it the wrong guy. Went all the way back for a touchdown. So I was.
And steps Doug.
Yeah.
And wrong color jersey.
Yeah, exactly.
And you're
right.
Still having nightmares to this day about that play.
But Doug was right. I mean, we did have great camaraderie, and you know, and when Greg was there too, it was the same.
So you were a junior when all this was taking place. How did you follow up the next season?
We don't want to talk about next season.
All right. 75 only.
We lost all these guys, and you know, we went back to the regular Lincoln football after that, you know.
That's where it all started.
Pass it over to Dave. Dave, you got one? Tell him who you are.
Dave Bisking. They're all the games. I think Bloomington was probably one of the best for us, but you know, we really wanted to pay them back, and we did. But it started right there. We could tell there was momentum. And each game, as we kept going along, I think Champagne was circled for Coach Mack. He really wanted to get Champagne. When we got that, it was like that whole night, like Zeke said, one of the best stories was we were out in the field. I remember it came out, and even in the crowd, that, you know, Danville just got beat. It was just like an extra bolt of lightning actually did hit right at the end of the game. And I can remember Coach Mack being on top of the world. And he led the charge going back out. And that was probably one of my favorite moments, watching him like a little kid out there diving on the field. I mean, it did. It rained. It just like opened up right at the end of the game. And that was probably one of the best. But that was a great, great, great time. Great time.
Well, let's not. So everybody's got their favorite story in. The season ran along and ran along, and you go 9-0. And now let's talk about that game.
Oh, no.
Oh, you don't even want to.
Yeah.
They went on a
jawing in that game.
Yeah.
Were they a good team?
Yeah.
They're lucky.
Yeah.
No.
They
were 6-3. They were lucky. They shouldn't even been in there. Because the year before, we were 6-3. We didn't make it.
Who was their big stud? Trello or whatever?
Phil Trello. He was all state that year. And then he went on to Carbondale. He was down there with me. At Carbondale.
And they played for a state championship.
Yeah,
right?
They did. They ended up playing Joliet Catholic. And yeah. I think
so that just hurts a little bit more.
9-8.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because when we lose tonight, there's so many things in that game. That safety in the first half. We're down 2-0 at half. And then Gus didn't play at all in the first half. And then he finally talked Coach Mack into letting him get in there. And then we pretty much scored. And then
we scored as soon as he came in. We scored.
And but we were really, you know, the defense.
We were down 9-0 when he came in.
Yeah.
And we lost 9-8.
the ball just didn't go our way. Yeah, it's still I think there's about every day there's times when you talk about football, Lincoln football, we don't want to talk about that game.
But yeah. Obviously, I mean, Lincoln's kind of, to say the least, they've been struggling since. Yeah. Is there something that you would tell these kids these days, the kids playing right now? Is there a message that you'd send to them? I know we need to turn this program around and, you know, get some wins because, you know, winning is, you know, makes other kids come out and play, and it's something to work for. Is there a message or something you'd like to tell these kids?
I think Coach Shoup, today? Coach Shoup and I kind of talked about that a couple weeks ago. Coach, you can take that one.
Well, I'm a firm believer in multi-sport athletes because I've watched sports for years. They're very similar. Mm-hmm. Wrestling similar to football, your footwork especially. And the way football is today, the first thing you got to be able to do is run. If you can't run, you're not going to be very good. So I coached in Kentucky about 5 years ago for 3 years, and football has totally changed. I had to relearn a lot of things, but it's all speed now. Okay. Throwing the ball in speed. If you can't run, you're in trouble. You got to catch them.
I want to throw one more stat out there because I inadvertently left it out, but the leading tacklers are on here.
Yeah.
Zerkhammer was 74.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's linebackers.
Were you? You weren't a pile jumper, were you?
No.
What?
Pile jumper?
Oh, no.
No?
Oh, yeah. Tommy almost got you.
Randy Feast with 60.
Yeah.
The great Dave Klim with 58.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Tommy Schoenauer had 50 guys trip over him.
I want to recount on that.
Yeah.
Three and out.
Bobby Cody, 43. Well, if they're not getting many offensive plays, you can't get more tackles, right?
Yeah. We controlled the ball.
We controlled the clock. We controlled the clock.
The clock
was always running.
Get ahead and control the clock.
No, but I mean, one of the things, too, you talk about that team, you can't take away from the coaching staff that we have.
Oh, yeah.
Because we were a group of good individuals athletically, but we had our incorrigible moments and stuff like that. And
well, you were held accountable.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember the –
But they found a way to coach us, you know, and stuff to where, you know, the talents that were on that team harnessed. And I think Doug and Dave sort of hit it right. We all came together every fall for 4 years, from our freshman years. And like Kevin said earlier, even in youth football, a lot of us played that. But every fall, we all got together. You might not have hung out with anybody for the whole year until that fall.
Yeah.
But that fall, it was all about football, and we enjoyed it. And I think that, too, would help, you know, just to stick with it as a group.
You got to be a family.
You know, and
Well, anybody want to give a shout out there to anybody? You got some people listening somewhere else in the world? Or?
Yeah. I do. So there was the juniors that actually I was looking. The juniors were most of our receivers. So from my class, Stan Hawk, the people that are not here, Stan Hawkins, Greg Cox, Kirk Billy,
John
Maurer, Greg Boyd.
Remember those guys.
And one point, the question was asked about Lincoln football. And if you look around this group, we played two and three sports.
Yep.
And I played basketball too all 4 years. Lincoln's a basketball town, but I think you got to get these kids involved year round playing different sports. I think it's good for the kids. And it's good for the teams, actually.
Well, another thing, kids these days have things that you guys didn't in the past.
Yeah.
They want to sit down in the basement, play Xbox, where back in 1975, 74, 73, even when you guys are in junior high, you guys were meeting at a park playing.
Yeah.
We didn't have cell phones, you know. And, you know, you guys would – I don't know how you guys called each other back then. Was it telegraph or back then?
Smoke signals.
Well, you guys would get
loud cars.
Yeah. You guys would meet at a park, and you would
Ironically, one of the things we did a lot on the Sundays after the games was we'd go out to Memorial Park, and we'd play flag football with guys that were
graduated. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Kent Bowlby, I'll give a shout-out to, was one of the best – unknown wide receivers of Logan County at Memorial Park. That man he was like Freddie Biletnikoff. He'd just fly across the air and catch him across the middle.
Yeah. So I think that's one of the issues with today's kids. You know, we have all kinds of big kids in Lincoln. What are they doing? Nothing.
Yeah.
You know, we need to get them on the football field or, you know, the baseball field or something. But
well, I think, too, it gets back to that coaching staff, too. The coaches made us want to play.
Right.
They, that's what brought us back, you know, the camaraderie. And we had some really good coaches. And not to take away from any of the coaches that have been at Lincoln since.
Kids are different these days. You can – back then, if somebody got in your face, you responded. You yell at a kid these days, they might just quit. yeah. you know, or give up. Or
Have their parents
you know,
come out.
Yeah. Have their parents come out. Yeah. You know, yeah. Coach so-and-so's yelling at me. He's not giving me a fair shot. So, yeah.
Yes, they did.
So it's different yeah, times.
It wasn't pretty.
You know?
It wasn't pretty.
Respect with our coaches.
Exactly.
You know, and their mutual respect. And I think that was
saying how we respected our coaches. And when you have a coach that really believes in you, it makes you want to do more to please them. And when you make a good play and they're the first one to congratulate
Absolutely.
You, it makes the world of difference. It really did. And I respected those three coaches immensely. And
still do to this day.
And still do to this day, you know. And I think that makes a big difference in your attitude, how you play. If you both believe in each other, I think you can get a lot of things done, you know.
So who wants to be the spokesman and tell us a little bit about what's going on today? Tommy,
well,
and they may
here,
and they may have you. There'll be a photo op right later on. Some of these fans will come out and get their pictures taken with you guys.
Autograph session.
Cody's charging $20. I'll do $19.95. So. But no, we're here today, obviously on the radio with you, Joe, and thank you for remembering us after all these years.
We've really never forgotten you guys.
Kind of nice to see that. But then we're going to leave here and we're heading out to the high school. We're going to take a. What of the team that showed up here for the reunion, take a photograph. They're going to pull the Big 12 championship trophy out. And then we're all going to meet over at the KC Hall for a little luncheon and soda pop and stuff like that.
All right. Well, good for you guys.
We're also going to have, hopefully they'll make it, Dan Ott, his parents, Charlie and Marge Ott, and Ed and Joe Pluth out there for lunch. And
good.
And then Coach Tony Mac's McDonald, wife. Coach Mack's wife's coming
Coach
out too,
Mac's wife.
And stuff. So it'll be good to see them all. Yeah.
It'll be great. And you know what? That's I tell you guys this all the time. You're legends around here.
Yeah.
We all talk about. We all walk in there and look around at those guys and look at those pictures. And
all the hair.
Probably make fun of you guys a little bit. Really, you guys are pretty well keeping your hair.
Yeah. No.
Okay. Well,
yeah.
Well, there was that story where you told Coach Mack wanted us to get our hair cut. And you said, Coach, if we cut our hair, Coach, we'll lose. He says, okay, as soon as you lose, you guys are going to get your hair cut like the 69 boys. But we didn't lose.
Maybe that's a key. Let the hair grow.
A lot of hair.
Mid-70s, come on.
Well, I tell you what, we sure like to thank you guys for all coming out.
And thanks
for having that special team out there at Lincoln High School. And good luck to all of you.
Football program, get off and get going again.
Yeah, I say.
Whatever we can do to help, we'll try to encourage them, but.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
we'd love to see that.
Yeah, we'll get you. As I say, we have to get you out to talk at a game. Go ahead. Take that, Dave. Dave.
Hey, I'd like to thank Dave.
As I say.
Gus, Tommy, I think Bobby, you ran on it, and Zeke for putting the whole thing together. I know they did a lot of work to put this all together. So. No.
Yeah.
Well, thanks, guys, and we're going to welcome you back here. Maybe, well, you just do a 50, you won't come back in 45, will you?
Right.
If we're
10 years?
You never know.
And this video will be out there, so we're going to see how much you change.
And we'll be big time by then. We'll be on the.
We'll probably look younger.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for coming out. That's a 1975 football team.
Yeah, and if you guys want to watch, this will be online, WLCNonline.com. He usually has them up Sunday night, Monday morning, so your family wants to check it out, and you know everybody across the world can see it, and you know, and it's on TV. It'll be on Channel 5 here in local cable network. So, I want to thank you guys for coming today.
One last shout out, Joe, to my mother, Mary Ann Shona.
Yep, Mary Ann Shona.
I'll be seeing shortly, Ma.
Hey, and you know what? You look like her. You do, and I haven't seen you in a long time, but boy, when I looked at your face, you look like your mom.
Team mother, her and Gloria Gazowskis.
Yeah.
Team mother.
Yeah, we didn't talk about that, but you guys kind of used to hang around over there, right, Tom? Yeah. Okay. I guess we're letting that go.
My 84-year-old mother.
All right, that's going to do it for us here at the fairgrounds. 1975 football team, Lincoln Railers. Don't forget, join Big Daddy Jim, Jeff number 2, and Lisa the Fix 96 Prize Girl tonight live in the Merchants Building from 6 to 8 for the Classic Rock Experience. Bring 4 or more cans of non-perishable food items for the Lincoln Logan County Food Pantry, and you'll receive a great prize. Next week, we'll be downtown Emden at the Stagger Inn Bar and Family Friendly Grill for the annual ALS Walk Run. Don't forget about the Wiffle Ball Tournament at the KC's next Saturday. And from 10 to 2 today at the Lincoln IGA, Lincoln Youth Football Ribeye Sandwiches fundraiser. So get on out there, get you a sandwich. Chili cook-off going on today. Big concert tonight. I'd like to thank our listeners for tuning in. Till next time, you've been in the Cheap Seats on 96.3 FM.
Good day.